and a very warm welcome to Bharata First. You're watching Big Picture with Frank Rausen Pereira. And since you're here, I would like to thank you for your continued support. For those of you who haven't already subscribed, please subscribe, hit the bell icon, and then all notifications. Do follow our social media handles for all the latest updates, and you can also subscribe to our newsletter to get some incisive content. The Bharata First team is running a daily quiz. The winner will get to interview me in a program called Hot Seat that airs at 6 p.m. on Saturdays. Details are in the description of this video. There is also a contribution link for those who would like to come forward and contribute. A small step that you take will go a long way in ensuring that we continue to bring this content to you. So do continue to show your love and support. On to the discussion now. Well, the 2021 World Press Freedom Index, produced by Reporters Without Borders, a French NGO, has again placed India at 142nd rank out of 180 countries. This despite the fact that for a year, under directions from the Cabinet Secretary, an index monitoring cell worked to improve the world rankings, including a meeting between Ambassador to France with the RSF officials to lobby for a change in the ranking in the index compiled by them. The report noted that criminal prosecutions are used to gag journalists critical of authorities, including charges of sedition. In Kashmir, it said journalists still cope with utterly Orwellian content regulations. Norway is ranked number one in the index, followed by Finland, Sweden, Denmark, and Costa Rica. India's neighbour Pakistan ranks at 145. At the bottom of the index is Eritrea, with North Korea, Turkmenistan, and China preceding it. In this edition of Big Picture, we will analyze the Freedom of Press Index. Joining me on the program today are A.K. Bhattacharya, Editorial Director of the Business Standard, K.V. Prasad, Senior Journalist, and Urbi Goswami of the Economic Times. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on this edition of Big Picture. Mr. Bhattacharya, let me start the program with you first. You know, when we look at this index, we are ranked 142nd twice in a row. You know, the government has also set up some kind of a task force to try and ensure that we fix this particular index, but yet, you know, we've not been able to do that. What's the crux of the problem, and, you know, how would you look at this?
Well, let me begin by spending a minute on how I look at it. If you look at the index number of 142, as you rightly pointed out, that it remains constant. One way of saying, looking at this number would be that, we haven't really sort of fallen off the ladder very steeply. We have stayed at a time when Malaysia fell by 15 points, and there are many other, Myanmar fell by one notch. We have, kept our position at 142. So what is there to worry about? There would be many others who would say that apart from, our region, if you look at Nepal has done very well, Bhutan has done well, Maldives has done well in our region, and Sri Lanka has not done too well. As I said, Malaysia and Myanmar has done very badly. So, there's reason for us to, pat us on the back. But I have to look at the number 142 in a historical context. And the historical context is that 142 and the index started in 2013. Now, if you look at the start of the index of 2013, we were 140. And today, we are at 142. Which means while the global index has fallen by 12% in this period of 9 years, we have fallen just by 1.4%. So there will be another reason to pat us on the back. But, numbers are numbers, and we need to understand the very layers to see where we actually stand. And where we actually stand is quite pathetic. I'll tell you why. It's because 142... we began doing very well from 2013, and we came to a point of 133 in the index of among 180 countries in 2016. And from 2016, the steady decline started. You know, it is almost like the Indian economy, you know, which began falling from 2016 from 8% growth rate. And by 2021, it came down to 4% growth rate. And, you know, and 2021, it would be a negative growth rate. So it is like we, from 2013, from 142 to 2016, we improved to 133. And from 133 to 142 is a 7% fall. Now, if you look at this decline of 2016 to 2021, that is what we need to focus on, because the laws that prevail in this country that govern journalism have actually gone, become very, very regressive and become, very restrictive. So there's a sedition law. There is many other laws that are used against journalists. So, and even if you look at the kind of, you know, the journalists that have been killed on duty, that number has also increased. So on the whole, if you look at it, that 142 seems to be a no change scenario, and we should say, damn well, very good, well, job, good job done. But you must see the slide from 2016, which has been a 7% decline, and the commentary that the Reporter Without Borders have actually said, that how doing journalism in India is actually risking your own lives. So I think at the preliminary stage, I will just restrict my comment at this with these things, and I will pause.
Absolutely. All right. So K.V. Prasad, let me bring you to the picture now. So, you know, Mr. Bhattacharya has spoken about how the situation has been ever since the index came into being from 2013 to 2021. You know, you've been an editor for a really long time. You've been a journalist, a career journalist, of course, at that. How would you look at how journalism has progressed over the years and what it is like today in 2021 when this report is staring at us in our faces at 142 is where we stand?
Frank, I'll start with a disclaimer, saying that because I work for three of the most prestigious news organizations in this country, the Press Trust of India, the Hindu, and the Tribune. And in all these organizations, let me say, we had a different editorial standard. The kind of freedom a journalist had was totally different. So when I offer my comments, it will be largely in the context of my 30 years of career in these three organizations, little over 30 years. So, so that being the fact, yes, there has been a change in the way news itself is presenting itself, from starting from the days, as Mr. Bhattacharya would wear me out, where we were, the print medium was the primary source and also the most dynamic source of information gathering and information spreading. Over the years, that changed. And today, we are in the world of instant communication, where everybody with a smartphone or a phone is a journalist. How much of information that is being fed into the system, because the delivery mechanism itself has altered so much. What is being fed, how much of it is verified, that is an issue that we all see. And in fact, in this pandemic, the last 2 weeks or 3 weeks or 4 weeks that you notice, the number of messages that are doing on social media, many come back to say, hey, what are you sending? It doesn't work. So this is where journalism comes in differently, because most of us come with a trained efficiency, where we cross-check every bit of information before we release in the public sphere. That being the broad case, this is, I think, the broad brush that has altered. And this is a challenge which professional journalists are facing and will continue to face for quite a long time, unless we are addressing this challenge as to how to deal with this phenomena, where you are not only relevant, but are trusted. So these are the two combinations that we'll have to keep on working. And if you look at the parameters of the index that was worked out by a Reporter Sans Borders or whatever, we'll have to see at what indices have they taken. And let me tell you, there is a debate already on this country for a pretty long time. And even Mr. Bhattacharya would know that the Editors Guild had talked about it some time ago. The kind of pressures on rural people who practice in the rural and hinterlands in this country of journalists is totally different from the kind of pressures journalists face in urban atmosphere, urban milieu. So that being said, we'll have to look at it differently instead of using the same brush to paint media as such in this country.
Absolutely. Urmi Goswami, let me bring you into the picture and let's talk about another aspect. You know, You're someone who has environment very close to your heart. You know, you write and you speak about environment a lot. It's considered as, it's very important. I'm not putting down the importance of the environment and climate change and all those other aspects, but still it is seen as a very, very niche sector, right?
Right.
That is one. Secondly, you being a woman as well and going out there and doing your work, is it that much more difficult, do you think, for you?
Thank you for the question, and they're both very interesting questions. When it comes to the covering issues like environment, and I will actually take it a step further and to say it includes issues like education and health, it is truly somewhat of an uphill task. And I'll tell you why it's an uphill task. Not only, it's not just about convincing the editors that there is a story here. It's actually, these are issues on which everybody has an opinion, but very few people have the facts, you know? And I think that is the big problem. And so what happens a lot is because everybody has an opinion, things get molded in a certain way. The conversations get molded in a certain way. If you take a simple fact of environment, you know, somebody will say, oh, I know trees are being cut in my area. That's very bad. But somebody else will say, no, you need to cut the trees because you need to build a road. So everybody has an opinion without really having the facts about what is happening. Is there an effort to, set up compensatory afforestation? What are the steps being taken? What is the real impact of cutting these trees? Is there another option? So facts become almost become the first casualty, I think that becomes a problem. And that becomes a place where you will start having, say, whether a state or a authority or even others, they're sending you denials saying, oh, you have written this, but this is factually incorrect. And therefore, but now if a state does it, it becomes a bit repressive. But the fact of the matter is that, as Prasad said and before, is that we need to be able to have verifiable facts. And I think that is where the issue becomes a problem. And it's a bigger problem in sectors where everybody seems to have an opinion and some facts, but not enough to carry it through. So that's one. As a woman, I have to say this, that yes, there are places, there are times when you know that, as a woman, you have restrictions. You know, you will not do certain things, or you know that you cannot pursue a certain, you will find it more difficult to pursue a certain story. But, as working journalists, we always find our way out of those issues as well, no? You team up with a male colleague, you find another way of doing it. It's about, there are different ways to get to the, get to that end of the sort of story, because ultimately, what are you trying to do? You're trying to tell a story with facts so that others can make an informed decision. I think that's the critical part. And I think, both what AKB and Prasad said, I think that is the part that we need to remember, that what are we in the business of, actually? We are trusted to give facts so that people can make up their minds. I think that's where we start faltering.
So, right, Mr. Bhattacharya, since we are here, let's take this discussion forward. Some interesting points that have been made thus far. So where does the onus lie, or whose onus is it to ensure that we make some kind of a difference? Is it the onus of the media organization or the government, really? Because at the end of the day, what we need to see is a truly independent media and a media that can report a story as it is.
Well, to understand this scenario, we must categorize understand what are the three challenges. In my view, there are three challenges that face the media from what my colleagues on this panel actually mentioned, and to which I entirely agree. There is one challenge, which is an internal challenge, which is the media internal media house channel challenge, which is how you actually, you know, use stress on facts. I would go beyond stressing facts. Journalism and media is not just about facts. They're about facts and facts-based analysis and views. Because if we just give facts, then it doesn't make the entire body and soul of journalism. You need to intersperse those facts with facts-based analysis and facts-based opinion. So therefore, that is, you know, there is something I would say that we are failing to do in many cases, and we need to face up to those challenges of that internal standards are falling apart. So that is one kind of challenge. The second kind of challenge that we touched upon was the challenge that is coming from the external environment. And when I say the external environment, I mean the kind of rules and laws that have been framed of late, which actually restrict the functioning of journalism as such. If a journalist is not having access to information, then certainly his functioning is curtailed. If a journalist is always functioning with the fear in mind that if he does something by which his security will be compromised and he can be described as an anti-national, I would imagine that is a threat. That is a challenge that needs to be faced. The third challenge is coming, is an external environment challenge, but is very much linked to an internal challenge, which is the technology challenge. The technology challenge is actually making the media a field where the media practitioners must realize that they have competition from all over. They have competition from the social media practitioner. They have competition from the blogger. They have competition from the social media big giants, what many people call as the fangs. Now, these are the three different kinds of challenges that today's media is facing up to. Now, how do you handle those challenges? In brief, I would say that the first challenge, which is an internal challenge, requires tremendous amount of discipline, tremendous amount of training, tremendous amount of investment in resources to build those journalistic capabilities. And my fear is that the manner in which the Indian media particularly is constructed, where the business model of the Indian media is completely flawed, where 80% of your revenues come through advertising and only less than 20 or 15%, in some cases it is as less as 5%, is coming from the readers. So we have to move towards a new business model where the reader must be encouraged to pay for good content, because the advertiser must not have the call. This is the media is the only industry where the user does not pay. And I think we have to move towards a system where the user is made to pay, but the quality, the standards have to go up several notches if you want the readers to pay. So that is the way forward for meeting the internal challenge. The second challenge is coming from the rule makers or authorities. I think there has to be concerted campaign on the part of media organizations, media watchdog bodies, the Press Council of India, and also I would say that editors' bodies, journalists' bodies, to take up this case so that journalists are not continuing to function under those regressive laws. And the third is the technology challenge. And I think the media houses have their responsibility, and the media practitioners have the responsibility of practicing and using technology, training themselves with the various aspects of technology so that they can be on top of it and present content in a manner that is technologically more convenient to access and digest. And I think these are the three areas of challenges that I see, and we have to address them with equal attention.
Absolutely. So, K.V. Prasad, let's talk about another aspect. If you look at how, news gathering also is taking place these days, it's very different from what it used to be earlier. So is that also having an impact on the quality of journalism that we bring out on the whole, because, you know, if you look at it, investigative journalism, it doesn't exist anymore. I mean, it doesn't look like any journalist is bringing out or uncovering any true stories. It's just being done by other opposition political parties, or it's done out of hate amongst each other. And this is how stories are coming out. But real investigative journalism no longer exists.
Frank, I think there's always been a mix of investigative journalism in this country. Obviously, somebody has to tell you some story. It could be a source within a system, outside the system. But what a journalist does when their information is available, you cross it. You kind of make sure and test it against the touchstones of your which are available, and then run it through various internal mechanisms that are in place in forms of sub-editors, editors, whatnot. There is a whole system that is in place to, which goes through and makes sure that what is being released in the public sphere is something you can stand up for, both otherwise as a matter of veracity and trust, and also if necessary in the court of law. And a court of law, not necessarily any, it could be anywhere. You may be asked, and in the best court is a people's court. Eventually, every morning, you're responsible for what you're serving on a newspaper or in a 24-hour news channel, what the viewers are. That is one aspect. So there is a bit of, I don't say investigative journalism is not happening. A lot of it depends on your access to information. The basic information, how much is easily accessible. And if you stumble upon something, are you allowed to develop that particular area? Are you allowed to dig deeper and bring out some information? And here again, the internal challenge, as Mr. Bhattacharya pointed out, is very important. How much of your organization is willing to invest that kind of resource in a story? That's very important, because priority of every newspaper is different. Its readership is different. I'll talk in context of a newspaper, or for that matter, any media organization caters to a wide variety of people. For instance, when we started an agency, we were saying you have to write a copy that stands the scrutiny of the expert on the subject and a layman. So you need to present your copy in a way that it passes the muster of both people. So that is the way you are trained to cater to both sections within the same stream. So having said that, and third challenge is external, as Mr. Bhattacharya rightly put out, and probably Urmi would agree with me. My theory is, last few years, everybody's writing a blog or a Twitter or a Facebook. Who's reading? That's important. So as a journalist, if we ask this question ourselves, every day I dish out a copy, plucking out information which is there in the public sphere, just trying to collate that and spice it up, or not spice it up is the wrong word, bring some elements of journalistic touch and present it to a coherent story. Is that enough? Because today people know everything. They need to really know what is it. And as a journalist, we are trained to believe and trained to follow. There is always more than one side to a story. Are we able to bring those dimensions out? That, I think, is important. And that is where a trained journalist is knowing there's more than one side to a story. And we have been, I mean, right from beginning, from our training days, we are told views have to be kept separate. You may have your views. To give you a small analogy, I remember reading a book. It was an American journalism school book, where a young trainee goes to a sports reporter. He is assigned to go and watch the boxing match. And just as he leaves with his notebook, the editor calls him back, the sports editor, and tells him, listen, I'm sending you to cover the boxing match. Don't get inside the ring. That's a huge message sent across to the reporter. That means just watch from the sideline and report what's happening. Don't take sides. I mean, that's my takeaway. Thank you.
Absolutely. All right, Rupi Goswami, let me bring you in. Let's talk about this aspect as well, you know, trying to cover all dimensions. Is it also the case where probably things are not as bad as what some of these indices, you know, term it out to be? Is it as bad as what the Reporters Without Borders is suggesting, that, you know, we are 142nd in the world? Are things really that bad on the ground in India?
Well, you know, that's a very interesting question, because how Reporters Without Borders sort of deconstructs its index is something that we need to understand better. But the fact is that there is no single ground in India. I mean, all of us who are here are people who have worked in national media houses, you know, with national media, mainstream national media. These are entities which have, you know, strong presence, connections, doors open for us. But we also need to think about, you know, in regional media, we need to think about the reporter in a district and the kind of pressures that person faces. There are many stories which and anecdotes which are count too many to recount one by one, which predate this index, right? Where you will know in a district, a local sort of strongman actually bullies the reporter into the kind of reports he sends up. Or you will have somebody who is actually a part of that system who also, you know, doubles up as a reporter because the money that's paid to him to do the job is not enough. So he needs to be, play, say, real estate agent or commodities agent and reporter wearing three or four hats. And the moment you do that, that firewall between economic interests and editorial responsibility goes out of the window. You know, Bengal is having its election, so there's a lot of information that comes out of Bengal, and you would be astounded to hear of the stories of reporters who have been imprisoned. They have been imprisoned. Why? Because they showed a cop taking money, somebody taking bribes, or a local leader threatening somebody, and that is what sees them in jail. And they then need to rely on somebody else, maybe another political party, to save them. So where does that independence go? So it is, are things as bad on the ground? I will first say that we need to have a better assessment of what things are on our ground before we decide it is as bad or not. Because if you're sitting in Delhi or in Mumbai or in any of the bigger metros and you turn on the TV channel every night, you will see people criticizing the government or speaking in their favor, saying all manner of things. You open a newspaper, you will see views that are critical of the government, some that are not. I mean, and you will see all these people turn up the next day to make the same points again or write the next column or the next editorial or the next report. So then what would you say? You would say that there is no repression for them. There is safety. They can say what they have to without fear or favor. So clearly, it is not a singular picture. And I think it's time that we decide, we started viewing our own system better to understand what the problems are. And it's as, you know, AKB mentioned about the manner in which our media business is set up. Maybe that is where the answer lies in part, why we have the system, why we have a situation that we have. You know, it's very easy to find a reason to say and say that we do not have any freedom. Sometimes the question has to be, are we doing enough to safeguard our freedom? Whether that is in terms of a pushback or in terms of not giving anybody a toehold to question our space.
Absolutely. Very rightly said there. All right. Time to get quick closing comments now from all my panelists for the best way forward. Starting first with you, Mr. Bhattacharya.
Well, I think briefly, I think we should not doubt the findings of this survey. Instead, we should look within and trying to introspect what is going wrong, what is going right, and try to see, as Urmi rightly pointed out, the story is not restricted to the national media houses and the urban centers, but actually the real story of the Indian media is what is happening in the towns, smaller towns, tier two towns, tier three towns, and the regional media. Now, we need to focus on that and make a proper assessment, look at the various threats that we discussed, whether it is internal or external. And I think the onus will lie ultimately on the on journalists and the journalist organizations to take this battle forward. And ultimately, I think it is important to rely on readers as the final god. Because if readers discard you, We should take that as the right verdict, and readers should be the ultimate arbiter here. And the attempt should be to make sure that the readers are willing to pay for your content.
Absolutely. K.V. Prasad?
Well, I think I can't disagree anything of what Mr. Bharata has said or Urmi has said. The fact remains that there is a scope for introspection, and there is also a scope to look at the fact that very few media organizations, big or small, are willing to invest resources into trained journalists. It's something that you need to adapt as we go along. As technology has evolved, I don't see many media organizations investing the resources to kind of keep the workforce available to meet the challenge. It's more ad hoc. People have learned on the job, fair enough. But it's like you keep faltering and you keep learning. But there is no institutional arrangement that I have seen, whether it's a big or small organization. Smaller the organization, more difficult because of resource constraints. Larger the organization, there are different economics of scale that matter. But end of the day, yes, we have to introspect, learn from what we are told, while maybe tended to discard whatever reporters were. But I'm sure if there are good points, we learn from them. Similarly, if there are issues that need to cap and say, can we improve upon these factors? Sure, we learn. We can always improve. There's a scope for improvement every morning.
Absolutely. And Urmi Goswami, close the show for us with your concluding remarks.
Well, one is that you should never discard any assessment. There'll always be factors, but it's also critical to understand why certain conclusions have been drawn. It could be about a lack of understanding of our realities, which is our opportunity A, to either take corrective action or also to inform the world basically that there are certain realities. The realities of reporting in India is very different from reporting in France or in the United States. It's very interesting that the US is shown as a better performer in this survey. And if you remember that the Obama administration was known for its use of the Espionage Act against journalists. So, you know, it's about context. So if you're able to explain the context, that's one. But I think the biggest thing that we need to take away from this report is really about ourselves as persons in the media, as reporters, as journalists. Today, anybody with a cell phone is a journalist, but that is not necessarily a reporter. A reporter is, as Prasad, as AKB said, these are people with training who verify facts, who use facts to state their opinion, facts to inform the world. And that is critical. I think that is, we need to draw a line in the sand as well. We can't, that who is a reporter and who is not. And it's not about creating a club. It's really about saying, these are reporters you can trust because they believe, they verify what they're telling you. And these are, believe them at your own peril. So there's no negative list, but there's only a positive list. I think that is the critical part of the story.
True. All right. On that note, then, I'll call it a wrap on this edition of Big Picture. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on the program and putting things into perspective for us. What's coming out of this discussion is that we have to look within and introspect. Things may not be as bad as the report is portraying, but we still have to look at what is going wrong. We have to analyze the problems at large and come up with solutions. We also have to ensure more freedom and independence for reporters and have to train journalists and invest in the workforce to make them relevant. All stakeholders need to come on board to come up with viable solutions. One good possible solution is that the consumer should pay for the news so that advertisers don't call the shots. Once again, thank you for your continued support. For those of you who haven't already subscribed, please subscribe, hit the bell icon, and then all notifications. Do follow our social media handles for all the latest updates, and you can also subscribe to our newsletter to get some incisive content. The Bharata First team is running a daily quiz. The winner will get to interview me in a program called Hot Seat that airs at 6 p.m. on Saturdays. The details are in the description of this video. There is also a contribution link for those who would like to come forward and contribute. Remember, a small step that you take is a giant leap for us in continuing to bring this content to you. That's it from me. See you again next time.